You are listening to OffPlanet Radio at offplanetradio.com.
Well, good evening and welcome to OffPlanet TV, whenever, wherever, and however you happen to hear this across this, plane. What the hell is it we live on? Nobody's really too sure about that. This is the year-end edition of OffPlanet TV. I'm Randy Moggins, in case you didn't know that. And we do have a guest coming up later on tonight. We're going to reprise what we began a number of weeks ago with Suz Pratt, so she'll be popping in. She's trying a new computer out tonight, so this, it could be a white-knuckle ride, but hey, it's live TV. What do you want? It is the end of 2015 on the Babylonian calendar. Yes, that's right, folks. It is the Babylonian calendar. It is the end of the business cycle. A lot of people don't grasp the ritualism behind all of the things we observe as customs and ritual. This whole business cycle thing, when you begin to look at it, is really kind of huge. Here in the United States, certainly it starts now at Halloween, which is interesting, a satanic high ritual holiday known as Samhain. And I would call it a pagan holiday, but I don't want to offend my pagan friends out there. You guys were some of the originals and actually got it right because you followed Earth cycles. But so from Halloween, we riff into, here in the U.S. again, Thanksgiving, when we sit down and break bread in memory of a time when we conquered the native people. Oh, that's right. It was another frickin' ritual. So the day after Thanksgiving in the United States, we have what's called Black Friday. Well, supposedly Black Friday is when the retail establishments to the United States go from the red to the black, which begs the question, how in the hell do you have a business model where you run in the red for 10 months out of the year and then make it up in the final 6 weeks of a calendar year? Who does that? Well, the cabal does, the Illuminati-driven Babylonian magic number system of the Western economic structure does that, because that is how they keep you entrained into their system. The Matrix has to do with programming us. It has to do with us being predictable. It has to do with us being motivated to promote their goals. And it installs programs in us that keep us in cycles of entrainment. So the ritual continues throughout the month of December, with the countdown to Christmas, the 12 days of Christmas. Couldn't there have been 13? It would have been so much better that way. The festive holiday of Christmas, of course, is not an observation of the birth of Jesus Christ. Jesus was not born in winter. That's historically documentable. Moreover, it does appear that it is the observance of the Saturnalia and the Roman holiday system, and the observation of Tammuz in the old Babylonian system. So once again, you have all these interesting little symbols and icons that pop in. People who celebrate Christmas, look, you do what you do. I don't, because I know what it means, and I don't want to be predictable. I don't want to buy into their system. I don't want to be part of their commerce system. I do not want to help retailers who are stupid enough to run their business in the red for 11 months out of the year to balance their books on my consumerism by running up credit cards and debt. What do we got going on in the background there? Do I have a guest coming up? I bet I do. Oh, there she is.
Hello.
Good evening. Hi. Welcome, Suz.
I can't see you, Randy.
You can't see me? Well, then you got to turn your camera on.
No, I have the stupid Ferguson weather on. You were just there.
Okay. Well, you get yourself adjusted. I'm in the middle of a rant here. It's okay, Suz. Just do whatever you got to do. Tonight's show was designed to be loose, and loose it will be. But we do want to see your face, so as soon as you get your camera adjusted, Biggie maybe can walk you through this on chat, and we'll just continue riffing through some stuff here, because that's what we're going to do with Suz as well tonight. So the point being that the whole calendar system, the Gregorian calendar system, is largely cycles of predictability, cycles of commerce, and cycles to keep you entrained. Personally, I would go with a lunar calendar, bearing in mind, again, that the moon is an artificial satellite that was installed into our solar system probably about 300,000 years ago by, off-world entities. So we have that to deal with as well, but the cycles themselves need to be predicated on nature and not on the man-made economic cycles of Babylon, which is what we're dealing with. As we go out of this year, I'm not going to do a year in review because you can go anywhere and get that. And you can go anywhere you want and get news. I don't do news. One of the reasons why I don't do news is because it dates your shows. And these shows seem to have a shelf life of like forever. I get comments all the time on shows I did a decade ago. So I'm not going to date my shows. Hey, Suz, I'm getting vertigo watching you spin your camera there. Look at that. That's her bookshelf. She's in the library tonight. Yes, we'll be airing live from the library. But a couple of things that I do want to touch on as we go through this tonight. And a lot of it has to do with economics. One of the real threats that we face this year is going to be at least a drop in the economy, if not a complete economic collapse. That is if certain things do not happen. And some of those things that are going on in the background right now are designed to install a new economic system, not one that the cabal has handed to us, but one that is designed to transition us out of this old world system and into a world system of justice and equity. So if the cabal had their way, they would probably collapse the system right now because emergencies work real well for them. Their operative is order out of chaos. We're going to try and prevent the chaos from happening. And that goes into another aspect as well that, you know, I want to talk about this a little bit. One of the great failures of alternative media has been we have failed to reach out to the business communities. And by that, I do not mean the large corporations. The large corporations are corrupt. If we are going to transition into a new society and a new world, and we are going to be successful in bringing about the fall of the cabal, we are going to need to replace it with business dynamics. There is no way around it. The failure of communism and socialism globally, and that includes the system in the United States, which is socialist as well, has demonstrated that we do need a type of free market economics. That said, we do not need the type of capitalism that we were given. We do not need a debt-based monetary system. We need a monetary system that's based on the creation of value, based on actual value rendered rather than a constant cycle of debt. Anybody that has studied the economic system of the Western cabal world knows that it is a debt-based system which can only ever generate debt. It cannot generate value. This is why corporations are constantly running bonds, why businesses have to have ongoing lines of credit in order to operate, because the money supply is diminishing. all the time. In fact, we're so far beyond diminished that we're in debt hundreds of trillions of dollars here in the United States, as well as around the world. The planet, for all intents and purposes, according to Babylon's bookkeeping system, is bankrupt like about 4 million times. Well, there isn't enough value in the planet to pay back those debts. What will pay back those debts and what will balance the books is an equitable system where each person has consideration of value for what they render. That means that each person does contribute something. So what we're looking at is begin creating an economic system that creates value from the ground up, where businesses no longer fund themselves based on debt, but on the creation of value and the disusage of debt-based loan equity in corporations and businesses. By that, I mean a business who goes out today to secure capital must use a debt-based system. We are working with businessmen and economists around the planet now to attempt to establish an equity-based system. So those are some of the things that you're going to see in 2016. You're going to begin to see people moving forward proactively in the economic sector, but not like Babylon's system itself. Here in the U.S., I think in 2016, it's going to be the election that never is. If you look at what's going on here in the U.S. right now, there's only one person running for president, and that's Donald Trump. How do you feel about that? On the one hand, Trump appears to be saying all the things that most people want to hear in this country. And the other one, on the other hand, Trump is emblematic of the old economic model itself. And so are they serious about having an election? Is Obama going to wind up pulling off some coup d'etat that's going to enable him to stay in office? Or are we going to see the system itself taken back by the people of this country? These are all alternative futures that we all need to explore this year as we go into 2016. I looked at some of the memes that were riffing on the internet, quite frankly, it was a year of farce. I don't know how many people have tracked the flat earth thing. We kind of did a show on it. Let me state for the record here at the end of the year, I'm not a flat earther. I kind of am reserving my opinion about what form or shape this planet is. The flat earth people haven't made their case. That said, the round earth people, the ball people, well, they're kind of compromised by their own science and by the fact that we're reliant on NASA to provide us with any visual data, which they're doing by rendering graphics as so-called visuals from space. So the flat earth argument right now is a toss-up, and I don't plan to join either camp, and I suggest that go look at the information, go look at Zetetic cosmology, and look at the mathematics behind the ball model and the so-called flat earth model, and come to your own conclusions. That said, this argument has broken communities. It has divided people. It's also been a playground for some very subversive elements that have attempted to insinuate themselves into truther communities at the expense of the actual arguments and points that we need to be making. There isn't a lot of time right now to ponder on flat earth, ball earth. We need to instead look at what has been presented, make up our own minds, and then move forward with this, because we're not going to solve a problem by understanding whether we're living on a flat earth or a ball earth right now. I heard Catherine Austin Fitz say it's a psyop. My friend Rebecca Roth has said the same thing. And yet a number of credible people out there have done some extraordinary work in kind of exploding the ball earth theory. So, maybe it's a worthwhile topic to bring up. It's an argument that's not worth having at the expense of communities right now. So as we move out of this year, we want to move into next year. We want to attempt to find points of unity between communities. We need to pull together the alternative movements. The alternative movements have to be less didactic about their own ideology. One of the things that I've noted a number of times, especially in the law community, is that people who work in the realm of law tend to be theorists, and they tend to hold to their own theories at the expense of a broader picture. If we're going to operate in law, we have to understand that there are numerous types of law, everything from ecclesiastical, common law, uniform commercial code law, statutory law, and civil law. And when one goes into a battle legally, one needs to use the appropriate type of law for the venue and for the issue at hand. So, in fact, what we're looking at, again, is more divisive issues, because so many people out there in the law community are in love with their own theories and have created divisions within communities over legal theories. I think for those of us here in the United States, we have to stay close to our core documents. Certainly the Articles of Confederation, the Declaration of Independence, and then the original Organic Constitution are useful. Globally, we have the Magna Carta, and we need to adhere to that. Ultimately, we have the Law of Creator, which only says that we do no harm against another person or their property. So the core of law becomes very simple at that point. And as we go through this year, we are going to be looking at very huge legal issues that we are going to have to grapple with, because the economic system itself is enmeshed in the legal system. So my call for people in the alternative communities this year is be a little less rock-ribbed about your own theories and your own ideals, and come and sit down at the table. Let us talk together and let's establish a goal. If you're really in favor of overthrowing the cabal, the Illuminati, whatever you want to call them, then you need to get your shit together and you need to stop fighting among each other over niggling little details, whether it is law, whether it's flat earth, whether you believe that the ETs are friendly or the ETs are hostile, or you believe in ETs at all. The fact of the matter is the alternative communities need to come together on articles of commonality and begin to address the hardcore issues, or we are going to be enslaved and we are going to perish. So I see Suz Pratt's on the line. I hope she's functional at this point. She doesn't appear to be on screen right now. But as I said, this is kind of a loose show tonight. I don't do monologues for a reason. I don't find that I really enjoy doing them all that much. I like dialogues. I like sitting down and talking to people. And I have some fantastic people that I talk to behind the scenes right now. And some of those people will show up on this show over the course of the next year. Some people have noted, for instance, that Off Planet Radio has kind of moved away from what we used to do, which was much more in line with the UFO, ET type stuff. And yes, we still do that material. This weekend, you will have a new podcast. Oriana Love and I recorded a podcast last weekend, and we're going to talk about the Galactic Council. We're going to talk about the plans for the future of Earth. And I think in that interview, you'll get a sense as well of what the future can hold according to what is being communicated to us by off-world beings. So by no means do I intend to move away from the off-planet core issues, but it is also a time when we need to focus a little bit more on more earthbound things as well. So hopefully we address that and we keep a nice balance of material. At this point, it's probably a good time to say thank you to people. It is theoretically the end of a year. It is the end of a cycle. And so it's time to say thank you to some people. First off, to Mel and Biggie at CCN for making this show on live video possible this year. It was something that I never really envisioned doing. I'm still not actually all that comfortable with it either. The whole visual aspect is to me a little distracting, But at the same time, it's been an opportunity to expand things a little bit. I want to thank all of the guests who have appeared this year as well, with some special thanks to the folks over at the Liberty Beacon, Roger Landry, and the folks over there that I'm working with as well. And many people behind the scenes who have been supporters, people who have generously donated time, energy, thoughts, prayers, all of that is deeply appreciated as we close out this year. So without further ado, it appears as though we have live on camera with sound and ready to go. My guest tonight, Suz Pratt, welcome.
Good evening. Can you hear me now, Randy?
You could be a little louder.
A little louder?
A little louder would be
How
good.
How about now?
That's still kind of distorted.
Okay.
That's much better. That's actually very good. You just have to be a little closer.
Yeah, but I don't know where I'm looking at you. Where? What do you see? Do you see my face?
Well, I see the top of your head right now.
Are we in line?
Well, you should have feedback coming from the Zoom viewer. If you have your Zoom window up, you will be able to see real-time monitoring of video.
No, see, Randy, what happened is that I can't turn my camera around, so I don't even get to look at you.
Well, I can't have that. You must look at me.
I know, it's really bothering me, and I feel like it's part of our work tonight.
What are you using there? What is that?
It's me, Suz. Can you see me?
No. But why is your camera? Where is your camera relative to?
All right. Well, why don't we just put me out there to everybody right now and let them understand that I'm computer illiterate.
Well, now we see the top of your head again. So you either need to sit up or move something. Hey, folks, this is real time. It didn't get any better than this. Yeah. Now you've. Yeah, that's not really working for me. You need to get up close and there you go. Whatever you're doing there.
All right.
No, that's not working either.
I'm holding it. Can you believe this? On such an important evening.
Well, I don't know how important it is, but...
Well, I do.
What we're getting most of the time is the top of your head.
All right.
Why can't you see your screen?
Because right now I can't even see you.
No, but we see the desk and the floor.
You know what? I'm really getting upset.
Do you have a camera in front of you, or is this camera on the back of this device?
No, I'm supposed to have a place down at the bottom where I can change the camera from front facing.
From front to back. Okay.
Yes.
Well, see, I don't know how to do that because you're using a Surface Pro computer from Microsoft.
Well, wow. Just that you have to hold it and get it in the right place.
Empire.
Close so you can hear me.
Gates Revenge.
How are we doing now, Randy?
That's better. That's better. At least we got your face now. That's
all right,
good.
I'll move back so I can get a little more.
There should be an icon somewhere on your screen that lets you flip that camera around.
It's been there every other time, but this one, Randy.
Let me guess. You're running Windows 10, right?
Yes.
Oh, boy. We really got to talk. Did you see my Facebook post today?
Well, Randy, one of my dear friends sent me that link, how to disable Satan. But I don't know where it is right now.
No, that's okay.
Preparing for tonight's talk.
Tip to people who come on the show, test your tech before you come on. we're kind of beta testing
the
computer. It's okay. It really is okay. This is actually entertaining. I mean,
oh, you're okay. Having fun?
We're good. If you can stay like that, we're good.
Okay, now Joe has to go buy a Jeep so we can run away from the flood. So I don't know how we're going to do this unless Joe can get the camera turned around.
Well, I'll tell you what. Biggie, let's go to a break here.
Yeah, I'll go down
the break and give Suz about 6 to 8 minutes to technically pull this together. So we'll take a break here. We'll come back on the other side with more amusement and merriment on the live off-planet TV. Right. Welcome back to Off Planet TV. I'm Randy Moggins, and you'll note that our guest is back with us, Suz Pratt. And, you know, I've often heard people say, well, that wasn't very professional of you. Well, right. You know, screw that. I'm not a professional anyway. I know what that term means. I don't want to be a professional. This is alternative media. It's real. It's real people. You know, we're not sitting in CNN's $3.5 million studio with a bunch of poofy faced people with makeup cans and stuff. This is real shit here. So, you know, people come in, they set up, they've got computers. Sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. Sometimes the bandwidth doesn't work. I mean, there's a multitude of things to fail. And believe me, you do this long enough and you will not only go through the whole list of them, you invent new ones. That's what we do. Bigger and better crashes. I love it. Suz, welcome.
Bless your heart. Thank you.
It says, I'm feeling like, you know, I feel like maybe a 12-year-old in the back of the room throwing spitballs tonight.
They say I have a lot of CPU usage.
High CPU usage.
Whatever that is, right.
Yeah. Well, that means you're busting the clock cycles.
Well, you know what else, Randy, is I also cannot wear a watch. I stop watches. I have a very high electrical voltage, and that is the cat playing the piano as we speak.
Nice. Can we get more of that? That's, folks, live cat piano playing. It doesn't get any better. This is on Planet TV, you know.
Well, it is. And, you know, of course, the animals and the earth and Mother Gaia and the whole cosmos is now united.
Cats really are alien beings. They're not really from this planet anyway. And they know it. They've got advantage on us. They know they're hybrids.
You know, that's the thing. And it's so hard to start with this because we have so much to say about life charting. But we have some pretty other important stuff that is now strewn all over the floor.
Oh, I know. That's how I came in and dumped the whole toy box. I'm like my 3-year-old grandkid. I just dumped a whole bunch of toys on the floor and went, here, play with this.
Well, you know, we had discussed the entire idea that every one of us individually has suffered emotionally every traumatic thing that has happened on the planet. And recently, just today, I watched Courtney Brown's disclosure on Atlantis.
Yeah.
And did you see it yet?
I don't know what version of it you saw. I did that show with Courtney Brown in 2012 or 2013.
This is one basically where they are confirming spirit about how Atlantis was destroyed. So let's talk about business for a minute. Here we are. We are in the most corrupt society that does not allow for what is called right livelihood business, which is where you need to do something good for the individual or for the community or for the world in
general. I was talking about in my little rant at the beginning of the show, basically. Yeah. Actually a really good way to put it. I like that term, by the way.
Okay. So, well, that comes from Gerald Celente.
Yes.
Founder of the Trends Research Institute.
Yes.
So what happened back then? We have by Australia, a community that was living, working, you know, societal stuff. And then over by the Antarctic, we have another base that was basically military, industrial, the technical stuff, the computers. And they say that we are where we sit now technologically, 100 years inferior to where the Atlanteans were when they went down. Now, what they did was, besides misusing the power of crystals, which we've spoken about and I'm full of, they also did something that looks just like fracking, and the remote viewers saw that. So basically what happened was over on the Antarctica side. They knew they screwed up, just like they're doing now. They lied about the whole thing. And when the shit was going to hit the fan, they had 5 hours to let everybody know what was going to happen to them. Mm-hmm. And so basically, childbearing age women were put onto boats. The men were the ones that drove the boats and then, of course, sired the children. And they say that we all come from 2,000 pairs of people that repopulated after Atlantis. But what the bottom line is, for them to know that they were going to destroy the planet, and then if we have this collective memory, and you see, monkey do, and these people are doing it again. And now, right now, most of Missouri is flooding. I'm high on a hill.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, so if you have this happening in Missouri, and we know there's fracking below us, and then you also have California's tragedies, God bless them.
The methane, yes, the methane gas leak, massive leak.
And that was the same thing on Atlantis, Randy. They said that when they did that fracking, that the methane gas, oh, guess what? That's where the black goo comes from.
Yeah.
Yippee, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, of course, one thing I would like to say too, and just stop me if I say too much, because it's going to start jumping out. I've had to tell my clients over the last 3 days to pull their extra cash out of the bank. I've had to tell my clients to have at least 2 weeks of food and water. And that's including the animals too. I mean, it's your entire thing. And fortunately, we were sent a link, or I'm sorry, a blog, because you know I don't even know these technical terms, but a blog where this brilliant woman gives you a form letter. So what you're supposed to do is fill out your banking information. You're supposed to sign it. You're supposed to send it certified mail to the president of the bank and to the secretary of the bank. Now, I saw this yesterday. I sent it to you today. Tomorrow, the banks are open till noon. Tomorrow is the last day of this year.
Last day of the Babylonian money systems bookkeeping year. Yeah.
Right. So, theoretically, if we can pull this paperwork off, the money that would be in the bank, whether it's electronic transfer checks, which I don't participate in, or any other kind of feed into the bank, they have to respect that as a legal tender, theoretically, if you have that paperwork in. Now, in the last week, I have had so many things happen. And last Tuesday, I was getting ready for work. I was upstairs. And what do I see happen? A cop pulls up on the street going the wrong way, blocks the driveway of my neighbor and myself. Keep in mind, my neighbors both work for the city, and they're dirty as they come. These cops got out of their car with their hands on their holsters. You know my dad was a cop. Did I ever tell you that yet? I was raised by a cop.
Okay. No, I don't remember you saying that, but good.
Yeah. So anyhow, hands on their holsters, walked down my driveway, and we're in the backyard, and they were pointing at things on the ground. So they were pointing at siding. They were pointing at some wood. And, you know, if they were looking for a bad guy, you think they'd look behind the garage or behind a truck or behind a rock or whatever. But they were nitpicking our premises. And of course, I was nervous because, you know, I know what's going on. If I was just a fool, maybe I'd answer the door, which would be insane because we all know why. So as they were coming back up the driveway, they started banging on my door, like maybe they wanted to come get me. And my whole life, people have told me I am bad, I am wrong, I am paranoid. And of course, you know, and Biggie knows, and I know that they're monitoring me. I don't have a secret to hide. Bring it. Measure anything you got to do, because I'm telling the truth. And this is essential for people to get a grip on. And you know what? I even got it on videotape. Have some of that. So when it comes time, and I know they'll come, they're going to come for people's weapons. My dad was a policeman. So even if I didn't have a weapon, they would have probable cause to break my door down. Let's say that I was doing something that I feel is morally and ethically correct, but they feel is illegal. Well, now we lose everything too. And since I've been targeted from the time I was young, you can hear sirens in the back.
I do, yeah.
Right. So if I've been targeted this long and survived, and now I know why I've survived, and I know what my job is.
Wow, what was that?
That's the cat.
Playing piano.
Yes. Would you like to see? You want me to turn the camera?
No, that's okay. Just tell him Rachmaninoff.
So back to the story, okay? Joe and I, when we came together, because I have to tell the story, I am the whore and the virgin. I am the honored and the scorned. And it's not just because I'm a woman. You men have been put in that position too, to be honored, to be scorned, to be prostituted, to be belittled. And so part of this thing about balancing masculine and feminine attributes, my whole life, even though I look very female, I was in my masculine stance because, as you know, I'm commanding. And so anytime I'm out in the world associating with people, that is a woman's masculine side. Can you hear me? Hello?
I can hear you. Don't worry.
Okay. So it's hard not to see you again. I miss that. It wasn't until that I confessed my love for Joe that I was able to come into my feminine side, because I was able to unconditionally love someone that I knew every dirty, rotten thing about. She's never done this much. Dinkas. Knock it off, babies.
Yeah, she's just tuning up.
So, back to balancing our masculine and feminine sides. The only time a man gets to be in his feminine stance is when he is in his own home and he is nurturing and he is receptive. So right now, and believe me, I know that you are completely all man, but you are in your receptive female place right now, and you're safe and you're able to communicate. And so it's easy for a woman to be feminine when she's in her own home, receptive and welcoming. So I kind of got trailed off.
You did, but it was good.
Oh, because
let me just say this. Okay, because this is a conversation I had this weekend. I talked earlier about some of the conversations I have in the background, and they're always the ones that I kind of go, I wish we'd recorded that. But it was a conversation I had with two friends of mine out in Washington State, and the realization that we were coming to, that it was the rediscovery of the sacred feminine that was to bring about the healing of the wounded male. In other words, you had the suppressed feminine, but at the same time, you had the wounded male, which is the cause of wars and violence on the planet. Most spirits have been brutalized, victimized, sodomized, and bastardized for tens of thousands of years. And as a result of that, we have this imbalance that's ongoing, which is violence against women, violence against men, violence against children,
violence which is
the seedbed of all of this.
Right, right. It has to be put to bed, so to speak. So,
yes, it does, yeah.
Right.
It even goes back to the police officer thing as well, because the military and the police, you know, and I had a list of things that was like my riff list for tonight that I was going to talk about. And one of them had to do with the fact that aside from reaching out to business people, which I think you agree with, we also have to have an ongoing outreach to police and military. Many of the people in police and military are actually decent people.
Yes,
some of them are damaged, and they have a power trip going largely because of things that happened to them as well. And I can say that because I've known military and police people most of my life, and there are some phenomenally decent people among them. Some of them, by the way, we need right. the people on our side. But, you know, again, the imbalance of power is coming because of the abusive system that we have all been raised in, this cauldron of just ongoing aggression and mind control and trauma.
I heard something the other day that is a beautiful thing. And this, I believe, came from Liberty Beacon, that 70% of the military and 70% of the coppers are really good people.
This is great.
Yeah, it is. And they are ready at a moment's notice to dethrone the schmucks.
Yeah.
I believe that.
Yeah, there are. And I can tell you that based on, again, conversations in the background that they aren't so hidden, that there are, in fact, a lot of people ready to stand up right now. The military itself, the real military, not the quislings inside of the Pentagon,
right,
have been basically transmitting the message for a while now, basically through the militia and their emissaries, and saying that the American people need to express their will. It is for much the same reason the off-worlders have said, you know, we will help you when the appropriate time comes, but it has been hands off. Obviously, negative side of that is that we have had negative VT encounters ongoing for a very long time. Some of that's been scaled back as well. Again, to the listeners, offplanetradio.com, this weekend, I will be releasing a new interview with Ariana Love, and we're going to talk about some of the ET issues that go into this as well. But I say all that to say that we are at critical mass right now. We are sitting on the line of decision, and we need to approach all of this from the most expansive reservoir of love and humanity that we can summon. We need to stop the divisions. We need to stop the mind games. We need to stop the ego tripping and power tripping. And we need to get people together on a common page, which is we have a short window of time this year, 2016, to get this done.
I think you're going to be able to help me with this. In 1987, when I had my oldest daughter, when I got pregnant, which I take responsibility for, my ex told me to terminate her because we were just casual, you know, and I wanted to do the right thing. And I loved him as good as I could. And I got on that table, Randy, because that's where he took me. He drove me there. And God told me to get off the table. And I did. And I told him, screw you. I'll have this baby with you or without you. That's my opening story. And so I can remember crying when I was pregnant, because even as a young woman, I knew this time was coming, and I had had dreams about it throughout my childhood.
Yeah.
So if we get in far enough to the life charting tonight, I'll be able to expose it and flip through some pictures and do my thing, and I think I'm ready to go. But the point is that I spent my 30s talking about rapture and revelations. I lost stylists because they were terrified of what I was saying. I really offended a lot of people's spirits. And when we talk about shattering reality, and we made a joke about that last time, that's very serious. So that's going to be part of our equation. In 1987, they say that as the vibration on the planet went up, that we took in 10 times more information than we did in 1986. Let's just start there. And this was a big scientific study at the time. Each decade, it'd be the 10 times 10. And so if you can explain that, like as a hairdresser, I explain the pH of 9 is 10 times greater than the pH of 10. That, you know, that story.
Yeah, well, that's just chemistry. Yeah, right.
Right. Yeah. Okay, so if we take that back into the human being and understand or understand that we're taking in however many hundreds or thousands more bits of data, but over here you still have someone that is traumatized from not just their memories in this lifetime, but the continual evolution of their soul in and out of form. And if you remember just one traumatic thing from each lifetime, and then you come in and you add all that to that, that's why the people aren't able to function. And back to the police thing, when I did that YouTube about Mike Brown, because they murdered Mike Brown. I'm sorry. I know exactly what happened, and I detailed the whole thing, and that's what started the end of me in this town. I was not supposed to speak, and I did. So you, our listeners need to really take it to heart that these military people and these police people that have been weakened, whether it's with medication or microwave technology or cell phone stuff, or just not embracing all of their fourfold body, you know, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. They're being manipulated by the same kind of, you know, on the big military trucks where they put the satellite. And so it comes from the satellite down to the one on top of the army truck. And you could have a group of peaceful protesters and aim this thing. And the next thing you know, they all want to kill each other.
Yeah, it's basically psychotronic weaponry.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So,
and they're using that all the time, by the way. And that, let me dogleg off a minute just so we can bookmark
please,
this.
Please.
Is that the psychotronic weaponry is an aspect of a higher technology that's been embedded into the earth for a very long time as a result of alien technology, something that I guess a lot of people are still grappling with. The code of frequencies used to trigger violent behavior. This is even recorded in the Bible, where armies destroyed themselves, where, you know, energetic bolts came out of the sky and armies were destroyed, and they turned around and they destroyed each other. This is all part of matrix weaponry that has been deployed against humanity. So move from there. I just wanted to put that in there as part of the narrative.
Well, here's what I'd like to put in on that. Because, you know, I've been speaking to people all my days. Mm-hmm. Until I came on this computer, I never really talked about the alien thing. When I was pulled in and I met Courtney Brown and the remote viewing people in 2014, about 2 months in, I started to realize that maybe those couple years that I lost, more things happened to me than what I assumed. So I told you that I was almost shot. And what happened, because my parents were just ignorant, okay? My mom and dad left me with a general's wife, a Chinese woman that couldn't speak any English. And you know, when I was a kid, I played that game where you close your eyes and you spin around three times and you start walking. I was at Scott Air Force Base and I was walking through a tall field of grass. I was 5 years old. The grass was probably up to my chest. I was scared. I didn't know where I was. I came to a clearing, and where I was the berm behind where the targets are. And I'm sure you've been to a firing range. They say ready on the left, ready on the right, ready on the firing line. And when they went to turn the targets, I heard a voice scream out, and it said, "There's a kid back there." And my dad came running out, and he told me what a bad kid I was for being out there. Now, my dad was a simple man. He was an Aries. He was a child at heart. And the last 6 years of his life, we took care of him because he had had a bunch of mini strokes and he was living by himself and everything. And so one of the hardest things I had to do was explain to my father that I wasn't a bad kid for doing that. They weren't doing their parenting job. And he accepted that.
Yeah.
I got one more story, if I can tell it real quick on that. My mom couldn't love my dad because she couldn't love herself. And we can go into all sorts of stories about that. My mom always wanted to get away from my dad. When my mom got older, she had a major heart attack. And she was in the hospital, and my dad was so naive. He was holding her hand and thinking that maybe she loved him, you know, so they could bond. And he went to go to the bathroom. And my mom hit that nurse's button and said, "I claim my HIPAA rights. That man is crazy. He has a gun. I want him out of here." My dad slept with a gun. You know what I mean? Cops always wear guns on their bodies. So that was how my mom got away from my dad. And at the end of my mom's life, believe it or not, Joe and I went and we blessed her and we worked with Bach Essence and we gave her a crystal and she passed. So my job throughout my life has been telling the hard stories, whether it's about what someone's going to experience. And I always bought into that old story that when we pass out of our physical bodies, our loved ones meet us. We go to the party. We go through the white light, whatever. And then we judge ourselves because there is no God that is going to judge and condemn and burn in a lake of fire because you came here one time and screwed it up. Absolutely not. So what I've learned recently is really sickening, and I don't want to upset anyone, but I do have to speak this. What these son of a guns have been doing is recycling souls. So I always asked, okay, let's say that me and you's been friends for 10 years and I've been talking. And all of a sudden one day they come in And they forgot what I told them. And of course, I think everybody should listen when I tell them something. You know, I'm very passionate. And they, honest to God, don't remember. Now I know why. So if any of us cannot achieve 51% love and light, then we get recycled. No rest, no party, no reevaluation, no asking the angels what you want to give back to God, none of it. So these people come kind of half retarded. And then look how easy it is. I mean, seriously.
Yeah, I know what you're saying. It's
not fair that the, and I know life isn't fair, but God is, and God is love and light and everything divine. That's why it's so important this time that people at least get themselves to the place where they can retain their soul and get some development out of it, no matter what happens. Whether this world goes underwater, or whether there's a big explosion, or whether they drop some poison out of the sky. If we're vibrating where we need to be, and we know who we are, this is where the multidimensional reality comes in. So they say that when people pass, they don't even experience pain. It's an illusion because you go from one form to another. What if whatever happens, we actually do have these multidimensional realities, which have been verified now easy? I mean, look at the new X-Files thing. They've already got a dozen scripts or so written. So whatever happens in the real world, they can help people with it on TV. I mean, that's pretty cool. And I think it does give us something to work with. There will be some people that don't want to stay in physical form. That's okay. But this world is not going to end. We will stay in some kind of a form. And I believe in the wipe of a hand that everything could be okay. And the only reason I believe it is because ever since I got hooked up with y'all on the computer, okay, I've been having to tell people this. Either from the time I got on, the artificial intelligence wanted me so bad because I'm so full of emotion. I have a high electrical charge. I'm good to go. You know, I'd be great. And then they could build some kind of humanoid that would have emotion. Or that from the time I got on, and you guys were already doing your job long before I walked on the deal, we had some kind of a unification thing, which is what I've been stating loud and clear for 17 months. And that the work that all of you guys are doing, I mean, not just the on-air people, you know, we really are able to change what is happening. So in my kooky mind, come tomorrow, what we do tonight will bear some kind of fruit. We're that short on time.
Mm-hmm. I first off don't see this world being destroyed.
Either do I.
I do see all the attempts that have been made to terraform it and to change the biological forms on the planet.
Right.
And that has actually been mitigated as well. That's one of the things that I believe the off-worlders have done.
Right.
That said, the cycles that we've been stuck in, which are karma, which are not natural to us, we are eternal beings and we do experience life incarnations, but the looping of souls has been ongoing for it's hard to put time on it because outside of this realm, time is irrelevant anyway. But certainly there's been a hijacking of souls. There has been trauma inflicted on souls between lives in what you would call Bardot. And for a good view of this, by the way, listeners, there's an excellent book out there, Dr. Michael Newton. It's called The Journey of Souls, and it is his journal of hypnosis sessions with hundreds of patients in past life and reincarnation experiences. And it's very telling as to informing what we're talking about tonight, because under hypnosis, patients revealed some spectacular things about what goes on after life, between lives, even beings who are allowed to go into other worlds and beings who are allowed to go to different levels of evolvement to a point where they actually are allowed to begin playing with even creating stars and things like that. Pretty interesting stuff. I mean, we look at this life, and because we're so attenuated to the earth frequency and the fact that we're rooted in this body that we walk around in, the earth suit, we don't really imagine the worlds and realms that lie beyond us here in terms of experience or what we've been through in previous life cycles as well, which kind of, you know, I guess even goes into the life charting thing, which, you know, we do want to get into.
Yeah, let's.
But one of the things about that's interesting about you, Suz, first off, you've been at this a very short time. You've absorbed what I would call the base material, largely by osmosis, largely because of your own experiences. You were just getting, confirmation of spirit.
Right.
Well, you didn't data mine all this stuff. And that's why, you know, going through your stories here is important for people to understand that we are all coming together in a sort of universal database that's connecting bits of information right now that are fragmented and kind of serialized out there. But all of this is coming together in a very organic way, and people are at different levels of their unfolding right now. That's why I said earlier in the show tonight, we have to put aside the divisiveness that the alternative communities have been experiencing. And where we cannot put those aside, we then need to, as communities, begin to shunt those people out of our system and leave them to their own devices, because we have to move on here. So I said all that to kind of take us to a place where we can maybe tidy up the life charting thing again. I know there was probably some feedback on your end as well as my end the last time as to what this life charting entails. How do we use this to move us through our life? I mean, we chart our life, we see all these key points. Now, how do we move forward through life charting? What is the net gain from all of this?
The net gain is by actually doing the work, the person's physiology and all their little chemicals and all of these things start changing in their bodies. A lot of people, Randy, want someone perfect or without sin that will bring them the information. And I know that I'm here to be judged. If anybody wants, they can crucify me. I've already put myself on. Everybody's going to hear it. So a couple of my clients asked a question that I think that when I tell you, it's going to blow your mind. All right. They want to know why, if I had such a terrible mother that couldn't love me, that actually might have tried to kill me a little bit along the way, someone that taught me to lie and manipulate, someone that brought all the darkness instead of the light. And then if I have a daughter that quits loving me, then I must be evil. And what I said to those people is, I said, you know what? everybody has heard that little story about the devil on one shoulder and the angel on the other. I kicked that devil off when I was 16, and I'll tell you how. Now, if I was taught to lie and manipulate and use my sexuality to get what I want, well, I decided to quit lying. Mm. Why should I let any man control me and tell me I can't? I was a cheerleader. All right, I can't smoke, I can't drink, and I can't go out with my cheerleader buddies. Guess what I did? All of them, right? Now, when he snuck in my room and tore it apart and found all my paraphernalia and laid it out on the floor and grabbed me when I came up the stairs, and because he loved me so much, he didn't hit me in the face. He took his fist and he broke it on my attic wall. I grew up in an old house, so you know the wood was strong. He wanted me to drive him to the hospital. That's the day I broke up with him, okay? So I'm 16 years old and I say, I am not going to lie anymore. Well, wait a second. I'm already caught in a couple lies. I got to backpedal to get out of those lies, right? And a lot of us lie. They call it white lies. It won't hurt anybody, and you're doing it to make your kid happy or to make your husband happy or whoever. That is the early parts of that soul getting sucked out in my experience. So if a person does not know who they are, either because they tell tall tales or because they are controlled by the need for approval, how can they get a proper ego? They can't. And of course, the lies are only going to go on until the brain crystallizes and shuts down and the glands quit functioning and all of these things. So,
well, let me interject something here, because okay, this is something that I went back to based on my own background and raising children.
Yes.
The first lie is the one you tell yourself, because that's the seedbed for every other lie that you're going to generate off of that. And that really is kind of, if there is any such thing, the original sin, it originates with the ego and the false identity. Because we're really many people. I mean, we think of ourselves as one person, as the I, but it was the Russian philosopher P.D. Ouspensky who studied this and realized that we spin off little eyes all the time, little fragments of ego that then become identifiers for a fraction of ourself that operates in a particular zone, a particular space and time. So these behaviors and the concept of lies is something that we spin off as a result of this egoic identification.
And we do it because we all just want to be loved.
Yeah. Most first by ourselves. And how much easier is it when you're traumatized? Again, we go back to this whole thing. For many of us, we came in traumatized. I mean, birth is trauma, especially the way we do it now. I mean, my gosh, you come in and you're yanked out of the womb into a glaring light and you're smacked. If you're a male, you're circumcised, which is violence done to the most personal and sensitive part of your body. And, you know, there's things that are done to women that are just as horrific too.
Yes, there are.
But the bottom line is that, you know, right stepping out of the womb, we're already pretty wounded. And a lot of us are carrying wounds that are prenatal,
right,
pre-incarnation, inner incarnation. So we carry all of this baggage in us and we don't even realize it. And then people wonder why we're so-called evil.
I do have something that helped me a lot that I'd like to share with everybody. I started becoming a holistic stylist in the 90s. and I was doing wellness seminars. You know, whether it was about blood type or nutrition or whatever. And have you ever heard of the Bach flower essences?
I have, and I'm not that familiar with, but yeah, I've heard of it.
Okay.
Okay, but give the audience a little bit of a clue as to what that is, please.
All right. Dr. Edward Bach was a world-famous doctor who actually was credited for developing the first seven injectable no-sewed vaccines, which would be like dysentery and tetanus, the basic basics. Now, Edward Bach was a sickly boy, and he didn't get to be outside in nature much. That really affected him. So when he grew up and became a doctor, he felt guilty for giving people shots and hurting them. And he fell tragically ill in his 30s. And you can imagine all his doctor buddies, friends around him. And they did a surgery on him. They didn't call it cancer back then, of course. And they said that they removed a mass from him. And so he was in the hospital, and they said, wrap it up. You know, you've got a few weeks left to live. And he said that he was sitting in that hospital bed, and that an angel of the Lord came to him and told him that he wasn't going to die. He was going to pick the flowers to alleviate human suffering. And he lived in England. So he went out into the field. And the first flower he came across was the impatience flower. You know, those little cutesy little flowers. And when he put the morning dew from the petal of the flower onto his lips, he felt impatient. So as you know, especially with homeopathy, like cures like. And so what he did is he would take those flower petals, float them in water, expose them to the sun for 24 hours, and make a mother tincture. You know how apple cider vinegar has the mother? That's how the Bach worked. Mm-hmm. And so you can take Bach, you can put it in your drink, you can put it in your food, you can put it on pulse points, you can put it under your tongue. You can use it in a million different ways.
Yeah, this is basically like a field effect of the ascent, of the essence of the whatever the flower, the
it's the vibrational essence.
The botanical is, yeah.
Right. So here's what's really cool. Check this out. 90% of all the people that ever use Bach, they just take it orally like we just talked about, but there's a more important way to use it. And it's called the Bach Flower Body Maps. So Dr. Bach believed that any scar that you have on your body is like a niche in your armor where a negative thing can come in and drive at you. Guess what our first scar is? The belly button, where we were separated from our life source. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That would be Star of Bethlehem, is the proper flower essence. So we would take 2 drops of Bach essence in 4 ounces of water. We would take organic cotton and get it wet and put it in our belly button. And then we would take and we would put it on our heart. And we would lay for 10 or 15 minutes. We're going to drink the rest of the water too. Here's what's going to happen. There will be a healing, and then there'll be a healing crisis. So it's like peeling an onion, yeah, layer after layer. And what happened with me, as an A blood type, I have a lot of adrenaline and cortisol. Like a lot of people would need an upper to have as much energy as I do. Back in the day, the way I used to deal with my life is 30 milligrams of Valium in the daytime and a cocktail at night. And at that time, like I told you, 70% of the time I was happy. The other 30% was killing me. So, am I going to be a fake liar and do a wellness seminar and pop a Valium? Or am I going to put it down? And so I put it down. That was 1995. And I started using the Bach. And I haven't used a Valium ever since. A lot of people, Randy, want to know why I'm so into all this health food stuff and all the vitamins and all the healing. And, oh, and they think I'm crazy because I don't drink. I quit drinking. I quit drinking and taking Valium and eating meat. And I had so many people think I went crazy. So why do I do all that if I smoke? And, you know, I said to them, I was like, now, if I had 100 bad habits and I gave up 80 of them, why are you condemning me for what I want to keep? Now, I didn't know the answer back then was control and oppression. I do now. So you ask how your viewers are going to incorporate life charting. Well, it's this whole concept. First, what they have to do is not beat themselves up for what they choose to do. They have to be responsible.
Exactly, exactly. This is really a key point, too.
Good.
You know, right. And culture wants to demonize certain things. If you went back and you look at TV and film from the 1940s through the 1960s, people smoked like chimneys. I mean, I grew up in a house of smokers. Everybody smoked. There were ashtrays everywhere.
Right.
And then the Surgeon General came out and said, cigarettes cause heart disease. And then cigarettes cause cancer. And yet, I knew people who never smoked, never drank, that had heart disease and or cancer. And you're kind of like, well, what's up with that? But see, what was once a mode then became demonized, and smokers became demonized, and cigarettes, any type of smoking became demonized. And many people would be surprised to know that if you use organic tobacco,
like National American Spirit, right?
Yeah, there is things to commend the use of tobacco. The Native Americans certainly knew it. The indigenous people knew that.
Right.
So, I mean, to beat up on one person's habit, we have to understand, again, going back to the theme of this, which I guess is kind of, we've got to put our petty divisions aside. What is right for me may not necessarily be right for you.
And we don't want to control anybody else's.
No.
You want control of ours.
It's like the whole cannabis issue, which has been blowing up for years. And I mean, look, I'm unabashed about this. I occasionally use cannabis. I'm not some stoner guy. I mean, but I find it therapeutic. And I also found that it's what kept me away from using Valium or any of the other pharmaceutical drugs as well.
That's right.
It was one means for me to cope with my own energetic and mood things. And besides that, damn it, how do you demonize something that comes from nature that we're now learning is so therapeutic?
Right, that God put here specifically for us to use.
Yeah.
Now
in the range of all that, there's abuses of everything, and we can take the abuses and argue, well, that needs to be banned. My point is, in a sensible, reasonable society with normally sensible people, behavioral controls aren't necessary. So, you know, your one perceived flaw relative to all the other things that you're doing in the range of things to better yourself isn't worth discussing.
But for the people that are trapped, whether it's by money or power or love, it's like an anathema to them. It's like a poison. It's not acceptable. If I would have tried to make everybody happy, that gave me a command. I really just don't even know who I would be at this point.
Well, you'd be a robot, and you would have your neural network fried from doing that.
Well, you know, that's what they wanted.
That's why the bard Shakespeare said, "To thine own self be true." Damn everybody else.
And that's why I did. I changed my entire life. I left my ex-husband. I realized my best friend of 25 years was my twin flame soulmate. And, you know, most people wouldn't allow their female, you know, to interact on the computer and talk to men. You see what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Him and I are together so we can do this work and totally trust each other. I wish that everybody on the planet could experience that, because whatever comes, whenever it comes, we have the ability to relate to our creator however we choose to. And I saw something that Elise had a link on, and it was really cool. I hope I said her name right. But a lot of people believe that when they pass out of their physical form, they go to the white light, nirvana, bliss place. And that's true. A lot of people do. There's some people that they want to be in the presence of Creator God and worship at the throne. Then there's people that want the actual bridegroom, all chemical situation, which is a trinity. And that starts to sound kind of freaky, because most people don't realize that reunion with the divine, with Creator God, if we had one word that we could have to describe that feeling, the word's another demonized word, which is an orgasm. Mm-hmm. And now we go back to Reich and all of his things. So I think that people want ecstasy, but in a plasticized world, what you get instead is a misuse of any of these energies, whether they be sexual or,
yeah.
I don't like to use the word magic.
Well, no, but we go from either a Madonna complex to pornography in about 2 seconds with all of that. The balance is, and you know, if you just take the Bible, for instance, what does it say? The marriage supper of the Lamb, the consummation.
Right.
The bridegroom going into the chamber. There's hidden within that and within the culture in which that was taken, a very strong sexual connotation.
Yes.
That we truncated out of this puritanical idea that sex was something that was supposed to be swept under the rug. Now we live in a culture where it's supposed to be vomited on the floor all over screens, and nobody has any sense of decorum about it. So we're still off balance here. But it is because we don't maintain spiritual balance on things. You know, when you bring things into spirit, you are able then to equilibrate it, to get it to a place where it's balanced and where the entity, the person, the persona, the soul is able to balance that out so that you're not shamed by it, nor are you flagrant about it. It has its proper place in everything. And sexuality is just one of those areas that we see that the most obviously, mainly because I think it's the most maligned.
Joe was the first person that ever defined the difference between sensuality and sexuality. I had never been in the presence of a man that was that profound, you know, to actually break it down like that. He's definitely really a special, unique individual. I want to get to some life charting. I don't want to get too far down.
No, that's okay. Go ahead.
What time is it?
Oh, we've got 28 minutes.
Okay. So let's talk about the most important thing.
Okay.
And that would be your business and your job. Let's focus there. When I was a young business owner, because, you know, I opened my salon when I was 21. And I guess I was about 25 or 26 around the time of this story. And my high school guidance counselor, who gave me the scholarship to go to beauty school because nobody else wanted it, he called me and he's like, would you do a presentation for some high school sophomores? And I was like, yeah, all right, man. So, of course, a lot of people think the people that are going to want to find out about cosmetology are all a bunch of ding-dongs or half-wits or stoners or whatever. And so when I would go, I would want them to listen to me. And of course, you know, they're doing other things and all that. And so I figured out how to do this. I took my four favorite subjects in high school: art, sociology, speech, and business organization. Because, you know, I was supposed to be a secretary. You know, I would have been a naughty secretary, right? Getting out of the chair, smoking, you know. Right? So anyhow, I took it and I charted it and showed how each one of those subjects benefited me in beauty school. And then I took it down, a flow chart, and applied it to being an independent contractor, which is a self-employed person. I've been self-employed since I was 19. Doesn't bother me a bit. Then, of course, as a business owner, those four skills came, you know, to be essential to me. And what we are on this internet is we're not entrepreneurs, we're multipreneurs. So now we have a whole different working model here. You know that I didn't realize that that was a life chart until about half a year ago. I developed that 25 years ago. And all of a sudden, I was like, wow, there's my first life chart I ever made, because, like, you were so kind saying, you know, all these illustrations and how beautiful they are. I don't know if I have one here. Joe kind of threw everything down. But
well, I know last week, the last time you were on, I commented that it was so refreshing to see something done that was by hand and was analog in a world where everything's so digitized.
Right. I got it. Okay. So, you know, we saw this one, which illustrates a decade cycle with the positive and these things that we will never call negative. Mm-hmm. We will look at them as stumbling blocks that we chose before we came here. I take responsibility for all that. I want to read something. You can never be lost. When have you ever been apart from me? You can never depart and never return, for we are continuous and indistinguishable. And that's Alex Gray on The Cosmic Christ. I told you that my oldest daughter blames me personally for destroying Atlantis. Me. Okay? And I know now, I have a much better idea. Maybe I was the girl or the guy or whatever I was that had to go tell everybody they had 5 hours. Maybe that was me. And maybe that's why I'm here now. I just watched that today, so it was like a whole revelation that hit me upside my head. But check this out. My daughter believes her original form was a siren. And you know what a siren is.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Now, she said she was forced to come by her siren sisters. Does it make any sense that an entity like that would be given or chose to go to parents that would terminate her, because then her hands would be clean? Do you see what I mean? The mortal sin would pass to me as a murderer. Now,
okay.
Well, I'm just saying, let's judge me. Come on. Because they all want to know who I am. I got no time to play. The reason that my daughter was born C-section is because the cord was wrapped around her neck. And when she was born, she tore her little raw face up. Do you see that? And they had to glove her. Does that talk about her personality even to this day? Do you see what I mean? Like we come in with things, like you said, and we're not really sure what they are, but they bear fruit as we go through our whole lives. And honestly, Randy, I'm so worried for her because she had another baby at the Tetrad Blood Moon. This baby was 9 pounds, 13 ounces. And the story is it just fell out. I've had three kids. I can't imagine that. But whatever, the baby fell out. And do you know that they've both been terribly ill since the time of that birth? My daughter is very ill right now. And so is my grandson. Now, anyone that isn't vibrating at 51% love and light, we've already talked about that, right? If every day that she's full of hatred and sadness and torture, is it possible that's why she's ill? And earlier, when you talked about heart disease, you know they say that people that pass of heart attacks either could not forgive themselves or someone else.
Oh, no. It's a literal heart attack.
Right.
And it has its roots inside the emotional body.
It does.
We manifest. Wow. You said something earlier.
Okay.
And I'll go back to this. You held that chart up and you said, I take responsibility for this, the positive and the negative. That does not mean that we burden bear for the rest of our lives on it. Taking responsibility is the beginning of healing a wound. Whether it's a wound inflicted by somebody else or wounds that we've taken on or wounds that are subliminal to us, either prior life or early childhood experience, birth experience, it doesn't matter. When we begin to own what happens to us, and this is consistent, by the way.
Yes.
With the conversations I've had with people with PTSD as a result of being in mind control projects.
Right.
People who are suffering from abduction, whether it's my labs or off planet. When they begin to take responsibility, they heal. And you take people who have had the most horrific things happen to them. And I will cite an example. My personal friend, Duncan O'Finian, and what happened to him as a child when he was taken into MKUltra and the experiments that were done on him.
I heard a little, yeah.
And anybody who knows Duncan personally knows that he could be a monster if he wanted to, but he chose not to go that path, and that he now works to derail the very people that did all that to him while at the same time not hating them. And that is a testimony to the ability to take responsibility for our own healing and what happens to us.
And it's also the most beautiful testament to get everybody to understand that even if you were born to a coven of witches that had everybody's Illuminati family in it.
Yep.
You are still a light being if you choose to be. And you can't say that all the, any kind of people are bad, whether it's the black, the white. No. Oh my gosh, there are the great people everywhere. And here again, it's just, if we're at the end of a cycle, like you said it so well a few weeks ago, New Age does not mean a ding-dong hippie that has no vocabulary and a bunch of crystals and can't function. It's an entirely different thing. So if we're going into this New Age and everybody, man, they want to believe so bad. They want to believe. But say like the story about the scarab, you can understand why people don't believe that I meditated with some incense and a scarab manifested. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's all right. Don't believe it. I even doused over it just to show people. But how could anyone that believes in miracles sit there and poo-poo everything off too? And I just think everybody's tired, and you have to be tired before the new thing comes. It's acceptable. But I really do hope that people check out the Bach Essence. And I would love to come back and do something in detail about that. But let's do some more of this.
Well, that, and what I want you to do is send me some links for some of this so we can post it out on the show notes for this. Because when I put these up on YouTube and on the website, I like to put resource materials for people. So send me some links for that. We will post links for this with the show, and it just becomes like another piece of research that people can reference.
You know, someone just taught me today how to do that link thing, and I did it. I sent two of them.
The link thing.
But I worked from 10:30 this morning till 6 tonight, and my biggest worry was just what happened, which was not being ready to
I've been doing this for 15 years and I come to mic and I'm not ready sometimes.
Hey, look, Randy.
My camera doesn't work or my mic, it doesn't. Look.
I just didn't want it to be me. Hey, look at this. Isn't this beautiful?
That's gorgeous. Yeah.
And of course, I colored all that. You know, everybody for Christmas this year got those adult coloring books, you know, those ladies coloring mandalas and framing them, you know, and putting them in their house. This is actually an old coloring book, and I had purchased several of them at a used book sale. So this is actually, I believe, of Celtic origin.
It looks Celtic, yeah.
Yeah, and I'm a little Celtic around the edges, of course. And this was what I sent to my daughter when she said to me, she feels no absence of my presence and that she wants me to take the hole that she ripped out of me and fill it with my own ego. So I've been told by many authority that I have worked all my karmic debt with that, and the rest is hers. You see what I mean? So I have no guilt. But she told me to get a beautiful piece of paper and write, I love you, so be it. And so I colored that picture and wrote those things. But you see, even something like that is actually a life chart. I've got the date. I've got the winter solstice.
Yeah, I was just going to interject that. That's a life chart, too. See, what we're really dealing with here is imprinting.
It is.
Yeah, we used to do this. Where I grew up in the 70s, so I was influenced by a number of things, and one of them was journaling. I kept journals. I actually still keep journals. I have little scribbly notepads all over the place. But it's not as formal now, but journaling, sketchbooks, all of that, graphology, things that are imprints. we're leaving an energetic signal of ourselves, and we're communicating something through a medium of paper.
Your life chart will make for excellent, excellent legacy. I mean, to leave that for your kids and your grandchildren.
Yeah.
Fantastic. A few things real quick, I guess. I got another pile, of course. When we talk about our work defining us, you know, when my parents and my grandmother was alive, they all had the kind of job where they were taken care of and they worked for the company until they retired and they got the gold watch or the silver tray. Now, when you think about how little small businesses left, I mean, it's just barely hanging on.
Yeah, it is.
Right. And
we're going to bring that back. We're changing that this year. We're going to do that.
Hey, I'm in a town where I can't use my hands to cut hair, they say. Well, guess what? All of a sudden, my business is online. You're in my creator studio. Mm-hmm. I do your hair. You're my model. I work on love offerings and donations. Mm-hmm. And that's why they're going to come bust my door down. And that's why I'm grateful, because you guys know what happened if it happens. Nothing's going to happen to me, though. I already know that.
Yeah.
I have no fear. Back in the 2005 time, and this to me is a life chart, I was already speaking out about how dangerous the drugs are. So there's confirmation of spirit. You see, part of a life chart. Mm-hmm. Here's the dollars and cents on cosmetics. And I don't know if you know this, but the reason they can get away with false labeling is because they don't have to disclose what a quasi-drug is. And a quasi-drug is in between a drug and a cosmetic. So anything that would lift the skin or grow hair, whatever, that is a quasi-drug.
Botox. Look at Botox. What is it?
Botulin.
Botulism.
Sterilized botulism.
It'll kill you if you ingest it, but you inject it in your face and you get nice full lips again.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
But
guess what? They did this thing where they were testing these people that are all jacked up with Botox and they cannot read the emotions of faces anymore. Isn't that funny? Their face freezes. But if they're looking at somebody like me that is very expressive and you see it all move around and, yeah, I am. I'm 52, you know, so I'm not.
Look at these Hollywood people.
I'd love to have a little tightness at this point. But
I'd like to pull up the, but look at the people in Hollywood. I mean, Joan Rivers was probably the poster child for plastic surgery and she made jokes about it. But some of these people, you look at them, they look like mannequins. They have, everything is false, nothing about them is real, and they no longer emanate a certain vibratory force that's natural to the symmetry of your face and the character of your being.
Well, and don't you imagine, Randy, that sucks a little bit of their soul out as well?
You think? Not to mention their wallets. I mean, Beverly Hills plastic surgeons are notoriously well paid.
Hey, can I crack you up for a minute?
Sure, why not?
All right.
We've been doing it to each other all evening.
Here's my 18th anniversary flyer. And you know, I'm a cut and paste girl. Okay. Check this one out.
Okay. So what are we, I can't quite.
Well, they're these spaceships, Randy.
Okay. Got it. See that now. Yeah.
And it says the St. Louis Herald. Hair Emporium celebrates 18th anniversary. Take us to your hair color leader.
Nice.
Right. Yeah, I thought so too.
Yeah, that's very off-planet.
I thought you'd appreciate that.
I do. I totally appreciate it. That's awesome.
Cut and paste, you see?
Yeah.
Right, I still do that.
I used to do cut and paste back in the day when you actually used scissors and glue. I mean,
me too.
Yeah,
I still do.
You learn to do as a paste up artist.
And you know what was so nice? My whole life, everybody mocked me for doing that and told me I wasn't good enough and that I needed to do it the computer way. And you know, I had never touched a computer. From 1985 to 2014, I had nothing to do with a computer, but this is when I became nationally board certified. And mm-hmm. You know, that's like having a PhD in hair color. Now, can you imagine, first someone tells you you're nothing because you're a lowly hairdresser. Then they tell you you're nothing because of where you live. And then they tell you you're nothing because you're not welcome in the town. And then they take the walls. And you really do have to know who you are and what you have to give at that point. So I knew when I changed my life that there would be repercussions. I want people to understand that too. If they're in a bad relationship or if they have to do something that offends somebody's spirit or hurts their feelings, there will be karmic retribution. I had mine, mm-hmm. Yep. But I was very honest about it from the time I read Steiner. And I knew that I was meant to be with Joe, but I was married to somebody else. And what am I going to do? Polygamy? No. Why? No. So I had to admit it, right? So Joe said back then when we got to that point, he said, do you want me to take the blame? I'll say I came on to you. I was like, oh, no, no, no. I told him I wanted to love him however he wanted me to love him. Can you imagine saying that to somebody? But this is the love of my life. There's Joe. He's like Jesus and the zigzag man, isn't he?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The divine spliff. Nice.
Right. Now, of course, a lot of the internet community is under the false assumption right now that their twin flame soulmate is some off-planet entity. And I'd like to tell everybody, be careful who you lay with.
Yeah, really.
All right. Do what you got to do, but make sure you know what you're doing. It is very rare that twin flames get to be together at the same time on the planet. They say usually one is in form and the other one is on the other side. And so the love that is sent, you know, works back and forth.
Yeah.
But I think that since I was always slotted for this work, that's how I knew. This is a picture of the woman that ran the Waldorf school. Remember we talked about Brian?
Right, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, this is her letter letting everybody know what her state was. And check this out. Her and her husband built the Waldorf school. And their oldest child, which was a boy, when he started kindergarten, he couldn't share his mom with other people. And so his mom and dad had to take him out of Waldorf and pay to put him in another school. So she died of uterine cancer. And now we're looking at the guilt that mother felt because she loved that child so much. And she let the child down in her mind. So I just wanted to say that when the scarab appeared, we lived in a building that wasn't fit to live in. But you see this mirror right here, Randy? Beautiful antique mirror.
Yeah.
Okay. When I was a little girl, and I had been burned. See, I don't have hair there.
Mm-hmm.
When my mom dumped, when she dumped boiling water on me, that's what was injured. And I was fortunate that I healed well. But when I was burned, my grandma and I came to Ferguson, to the same building that we lived in, to pay a bill. It was the Ferguson department store back in the day. As a child, I looked over the counter, and this mirror was on that wall, running long ways. So when I came to Ferguson, and I wanted to check out that building, because like I said, I'm a cop's kid, I want to know where the tunnels go. I want to know if the crackheads are downstairs. I need to know what's going on. There was that mirror. Amazing. All right.
All right. We've got 3 minutes here, so.
All right. One more thing. This is a drawing of an astral implant I pulled out of myself.
Mm-hmm.
I think one of the reasons I'm sovereign, because I pulled the tracking chip out of me.
We've seen a few of those, yeah. Mm.
It was on my chest, and it was like an open pore, like a blackhead. And I worked with a crystal for months, a double terminated Brazilian quartz. And one night, I was pushing on it, and it hurt. And I went in the bathroom and I told Joe and Chelsea, if I'm not out in a half hour, come in, I might have died. I'm doing surgery. But when I went in there, first the round part of the head came out and it was hard, like gristle or silica. And I put that tweezer on it. And I freaked out when I pulled that thing out and saw the little hooks. That's how they keep a hold of you. But what's so interesting is the doctor that's passed now that worked on me and said I had Lyme disease, which I'm not denying. I told him that story. And he's like, do you know the story of Job? And I'm like, yeah. And he's like, you don't need to suffer anymore. And I was like, I hear you, dude. But he didn't believe that this was an implant. And do you know, he saw me on February 19th of 2014. And when I got on the computer, I wanted to talk to him. And I called his office. He had passed on February 27th. My birthday was the 25th. I was the last person he saw. And I'm going to tell you this. When the phenomena spoke to me on September 1st, it was this old dude, gray hair guy, and he was disheveled, like he woke up in the middle of the night, because it was 1 a.m. by then. And he came out, and here's what he said. Is that nobody's going to believe who it is when they bring it out. And he also said that the room was getting hot and he needed the air conditioning turned on. When I met him and he told me that he could take care of me and that I had a beautiful face, you know, and he touched me like this, I got hot and I said, hey, Dr. Dick, you're making me hot. You know, I need to take this thing off. It could have only been one of three men that spoke to me in that transmission. It was Dr. Dick, off planet. And I'm just saying that so all the remote viewers and all the people that are watching, because it was either the doctor that delivered me and my daughter, or Dr. Dick, our Lyme disease friend, or I can't think of who the other guy was now. It doesn't matter because I know it was Dr. Dick. That was my grand opening of the shop and my daughter's baby shower, all rolled into one. See that big belly with the heart on it? That's my granddaughter. 2010 in review. Another way to chart. This is a perfect thing to end on. This is the call to define ourselves, written by Edward Everett Hale. He was the chaplain of the U.S. Senate.
Yeah, I'm familiar with who that is, yeah.
In the mid-20th century, and he says, I am only one, but still I am one. I cannot do everything, but still I can do something. And because I cannot do everything, I will not refuse to do something that I can do. And that's from the book Dynamic Freedoms, which was my
back in the time when we had philosophers and poets.
I love philosophy.
So do I.
I know.
Poetry. And we need to revive that again. We need to bring that wisdom back to our government.
Can I do one more? Or am I out of time?
One more.
I want to show you the look of trauma. We've got a traumatized child after getting ripped out of my arms. We have trauma here. We have trauma on my ex-husband. These two look like they're under some kind of spell, of course. Trauma. And on the day of the wet, I still do these people's hair.
Look at the eyes. Always when you look at
always look at the eyes.
Always look at the eyes and see if they agree, because people smile, but their eyes betray them.
Right. Yeah. Right. And look at the eyes there betraying, you see?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm done.
You're done. Well, we're not really done. We'll do this again, because there's lots of interesting stuff to talk about, and you're fun.
And I didn't even get to deliver half.
I need people to bounce off of. You put a microphone in front of me and my mouth goes off and it's dangerous. So
no, you're not.
So it's actually better when there's somebody else there.
You are compassionate when you give the truth. You can see it all over you.
I really enjoyed doing this subject matter. I think, I'm sorry, I talked over you there.
No, you didn't.
That's a big ass cup, by the way.
I know. I drink a lot of hot tea, so now I'm a terrorist.
That's what I need. I actually went through my tea. Anyway, we've got time to go freshen up our teas again. This is going to be the end of it.
The people that drink tea in garden now are terrorists.
Yeah, absolutely. Suz, thanks for being with us on this last program this year.
My pleasure, always.
It's going to wrap it up for this year. And I guess we'll be back, next year on the Babylonian calendar, and we're going to kick some things in the ass. Thanks again to all of you who have listened this year. You are why we do this show. Reach out to somebody. Become unified, and let's get this thing done this year. I'm Randy Moggins. This is Off Planet TV. The truth is out there. It's inside you, and we all need to reach a little bit deeper. We'll be back with another show next year. Namaste.